Hi all, my name is Victor. I'm from Oak Ridge National Laboratory. And today I'll be talking about robust learning with implicit residual networks. That's a joint project with Clayton Webster, who is currently at University of Tennessee at Knoxville and jointly at Behavioral Reinforcement Learning Lab at Leary LLC, also at Knoxville. Well, I want to apologize for posting this video a bit late, and I hope that not that many people will miss it because of this. I will try to be short as well. So this is a short overview of my talk. So let's start. What is this? Around a year ago, Oak Ridge National Lab hosted a town hall meeting on robust machine learning and AI approaches to increase trust. And among the questions discussed, these two were recognized as one of the most important. And specifically, we want to know how to build AI models that are accurate and stable, where the stability is with respect to variability and perturbations in the data. And we want to develop strategies for achieving this robustness through the choice of architecture, initialization, and optimization. This requires capabilities that go beyond black box tools developed by industry, the tools that often lack important properties such as stability and robustness. So what math needs to be done to enable these kind of advances in science? One possible question to ask is how to design a continuous machine learning model given the desired physical and analytical properties. And the immediate follow-up question is then how to design a proper discretization scheme to enforce the desired numerical properties. And that's the question we ask ourselves in this talk, in this project, basically. On the applied side, our interest is mostly in applications with noisy adversarial data, which come from experiments and simulation. Okay, so let's talk about neural networks as dynamical systems. And this point of view makes makes perfect sense for us because most of the people in our group come from the background, have background in numerical analysis and numerical solution of PDEs, ODEs, continuous models in general, coming from physical, chemical applications, other kind of applications. And it is natural for us to look at the deep neural networks, depicted here on the left part, as a some sort of approximation or discretization of the appropriately chosen continuous model, that being an ODE, PDE, integral location, or whatever other continuous model you want to consider. So when we have this model at hand, let's consider an ordinary differential equation model. So let's say we have this is an ODE, which depends on the known parameter. And now the goal is to find the optimal parameter values which minimize some given loss function with some given regularizers on a given data set. So that's the problem formulation. And let's talk about architectures now, approaches. Well, deep neural networks have been recognized for decades, probably already, as very successful tools to solve challenging problems in real life applications. This is because these networks are quite expressive and are very general good models, generally good models. However, I mean, they have a drawback, obviously. And the drawback is the exploding and vanishing gradients when you're trying to train the network, the deep network. This kind of issue obviously has been known for a long time and motivated a lot of research efforts to remove it. That's how residual networks have been proposed in 2016 to mitigate the issue of the vanishing gradients in training deep networks. And essentially, what the residual networks do, they propose to add an additional skip connection to the layer, skip connection over the single layer of a deep network, or this can be a group of layers as well. Doesn't matter. Can be whole small deep network itself with a skip connection on top of it. That's what it looks like. We have a skip connection, it's identity connection, and the original layer here. So, and it was shown indeed that, well, this approach allows to mitigate the vanishing gradients problem, speeds up the and simplifies the process of training such networks without sacrificing their expressive power. Well, a lot of follow-up works have been proposed after that, and different modifications of residual architectures. One of such modifications, for instance, is the reversible residual network, which allows to backpropagate through the network without storing activations. A very useful property which allows to save a lot of memory, which is a very, very precious resource when training large networks and large data sets. So such kind of architectures are reversible and memory efficient. Obviously, it didn't take people much time to connect the dots and realize that well, these residual architectures are nothing but numerical approximations of a continuous ODE model, and that's how neural ODEs have been proposed in 2018. Very good model, have been applied to many applications with a great level of success. Memory efficient, allows to use black box adaptive solvers, and there are plenty of such solvers available, libraries collected, well tested, so you just take one off the shelf and apply it to your problem and solve your problem. The drawback, the issue with such networks is that it can be difficult to train, but there is no free lunch, obviously, as usual. So our contribution to this field is here in the form of the implicit residual network. And we take a bit different approach than neural linear differential equations. We do not want to look at a system as a continuous system. We want to have a discrete system, but we want to use our intuition and our expertise in solving continuous systems, approximating continuous systems, to build a discrete system with a specific set of properties. And since we our interest here in this project is in stability and robustness of deep learning, when we talk about stability and robustness of numerical integration of ordinary differential equations, implicit methods is the way to go, and that's why implicit residual networks is our choice here. So that's the schematics of the network. That's how the of the layer. That's how the layer look like. The expression for the layers. We do still have the skip connection, obviously, but now what the output of the layer is not given explicitly, unlike the residual in the residual architectures. Instead, it is given as a fixed point of some appropriately chosen nonlinear map. Well, such networks can be memory efficient if done properly, implemented properly. And obviously, well, they have better stability properties than explicit architectures. That's the motivation to go implicit. Also, it can be pretty difficult. They can be pretty difficult to train, but again, no free lunch. Well, for those of you who know recurrent neural networks, this feedback loop connection we introduced to our layer can be familiar. And well, yes, there is a strong connection between implicit residual networks and recurrent networks. Well, this is one such connection. So these are two related architectures which have been proposed very recently, maybe within a month, several months after we started working on our problem and put the first draft of the paper to the archive. So this gives us the feeling that well, our problem is relevant and important and interesting to people because they're looking into it. But let me describe how these architectures are related to ours. So the authors of the of the first work, like actually two works, implicit deep learning and deep equilibrium models, they considered the problem of training recurrent neural networks. And the standard way to train RNNs is by doing the backpropagation through time, which essentially takes the recurrent layer and folds it into a sequence of standard feedforward layers. And instead of one recurrent layer, you have a sequence, a deep sequence of unfolded sequence of feedforward layers. And that immediately poses a constraint on the memory resources you have. So it introduces additional memory footprint when you train the network. And again, memory is a very precious resource. And some applications, RNNs are expected to converge to asymptotically converge to the fixed point, to the equilibrium point. And the authors of this work realized that and proposed to replace the backpropagation through time by explicit estimation of the equilibrium point. So essentially, they considered an infinite depth recurrent networks and looked at the asymptotic equilibrium point and learned it directly without unfolding the whole network. And the backpropagation is also done directly through the equilibrium point without the need to keep all these intermediate values. That's actually the approach we take as well. We also have an equilibrium or fixed point of the nonlinear map, which we estimate directly. And as you will see, the algorithm is memory efficient because it does not require storing intermediate activations. Well, the authors, the motivation of the first work to improve the memory complexity of the training process for RNNs. The motivation for the second authors is actually much closer to ours. They also realized that there is a connection between implicit schemes for ODEs and robust schemes for deep learning, and they proposed to use implicit variant of the residual layer instead of the classical one, as we do. Even the problem formulation is very similar, so the output of their layer is also expected to be a fixed point of the nonlinear function. However, they do not compute it explicitly as we do. So their network does not give you a fixed point. Instead, what it does, it takes a fixed number of steps towards the fixed point in the direction of the gradient of the residual. The approach is interesting, and I mean it's very very logical and easy to understand why the authors considered going to this direction. But I see two problems with this one, with this approach. Is that first, you do increase the memory footprint of the network. The memory complexity is worse because now you have to keep additional values. You do not converge to the fixed point. You don't go to the very end. You just stop somewhere in the middle. You don't even know where do you stop. That's the second problem. If you take a fixed number of steps, what do you have when you train your network on the training data? It can adjust to the training data. When you take like five steps, okay, it may mean something on the test data or unobserved data. I mean, those five steps may it's not clear how far it will tell. A fixed point can be interpreted. It's asymptotic. If you go to infinity, you will reach the fixed point, right? But when you take a fixed number of points of steps, I have problems interpreting this approach. However, I mean, the authors applied this idea to adversarial training. So they trained this network, they applied adversarial training to this network and demonstrated some good results. That's the limitations I see with their approach anyway. So as a motivation for going implicit, let's consider this baby toy linear ODE problem. It's a conservative Hamiltonian system, which is often used as a way to test stability of numerical schemes. So it's a linear system, which means that we can write it as in this form with matrix A encoding this system of two equations. So it is linear. We can find an analytical solution in this form where lambda, this matrix lambda, contains the eigenvalues of matrix A, and these eigenvalues will then determine the stability properties of the original continuous dynamics, obviously. And in order for the original solution to be stable, all we need is that the real parts of the eigenvalues of the matrix of the linear system are non-positive. So they must belong to the left half plane of the complex plane. Well, for the numerical solution, since we have the linear system, the numerical solution can also be found explicitly so the P is the transfer matrix of the method. I don't know how you call it. So it's the matrix of the method. So it's a function of A. It contains A in some form depending on the method you use. But in order for the numerical solution to be stable, after n steps, the condition for that is that the operator norm of this matrix is less or equal than 1, then so that the matrix multiply by itself. So you have norm to the power n. It does not grow without a bound. So now let's consider like four classical schemes you can apply to this to the system, and let's study their stability properties. So the forward Euler AK ResNet, that's our plain vanilla ResNet. So we have a forward Euler explicit scheme. We have a backward Euler. So it's friend, it's fully implicit variant of the forward Euler. We have a trapezoidal scheme, which is also implicit scheme. And we have a trapezoidal scheme is a symplectic integrator for this system. It's a geometric integrator also. And the Verlet scheme is also an explicit scheme, as well as the forward Euler. It's an explicit scheme, but it is a geometric integrator for this particular system. And the Verlet we are interested in Verlet scheme here because there are neural network architectures based on the Verlet scheme, following the analogy between forward Euler approximation and the ResNet. So there is a scheme based on Verlet scheme, and neural network architecture based on Verlet scheme. But what we can see here, so we know that the original true solution is conservative. So if you choose a point, the solution travels along the circle, so ellipsis in this case, because omega is not 1. When we apply the our numerical schemes to this system, what we see that the forward Euler is unconditionally unstable; it always goes to infinity. No matter how small h you take, the backward Euler is strictly conservative. It's always not conservative; it's diffusive. It's going to zero asymptotically, no matter how small h you take. Well, trapezoidal is, as I told already, it's a conservative, it's a geometric integrator. So, I mean, it stays on the correct trajectory. I mean, the values are not exact, obviously. I mean, each point does not, it's not the doesn't correspond to the correct point of the true trajectory, but it stays on the same geometrical geometrical path, right? The Verlet scheme is also a geometric integrator, but it's trapezoidal is unconditionally stable for this case. It's implicit scheme. Verlet is conditionally stable. It's a geometric integrator, but it is conditionally stable, and it can blow up easily if you choose the wrong parameters, wrong time step, or the wrong scale of the system. That's why we mentioned here, because again there are neural networks based on this kind of scheme, so something to keep in mind. So this is pretty much the same slide, but now it shows the stability regions of the mentioned methods, well, except the first one. This one shows the stability region of the original continuous system. So the left half plane is the one where if the eigenvalues of matrix A belong to the left half plane, to this gray part of the complex plane, then the system is stable. Same is true for all the for these three plots. So the the gray parts correspond to the stability regions of each of three earlier methods, forward, backward, trapezoidal. So what this means is that if the eigenvalues of matrix A, of the original matrix A, belong to this part of the complex plane, then forward order is stable. If eigenvalues belong to this part, gray part of the complex plane, then backward order is stable, and similarly to the trapezoidal scheme. And these pictures also illustrate us why forward Euler is unconditionally unstable, backward Euler is unconditionally not stable, but it's strictly diffusive. That's because, well, the eigenvalues of this system are purely imaginary, so they belong to the imaginary axis, and there is no way for forward Euler or backward Euler to contain those imaginary values in their stability regions except at exactly zero, which is obviously not possible. So, well, this is a very baby toy explanation. Everybody who took numerical analysis knows this is just one of numerical analysis, but the two takeaways from these two slides is that when we choose the neural network structure and neural network architecture, we need to be careful. Both structure and architecture matters. So that's something to keep in mind. Depending on the problem, different choices might be better. Some choices might be worse. That's important. Now let's talk about implicit layers, both the definition, implementation, and regularization. Regularization. Well, let's go back to the structure. Well, implicit layers give us the tool, give us the hammer. And now we have to apply the tool to the correct problem in order to make sense. To make sense, and that's where regularization will play important role. So, well, this is the definition of our implicit layer again. Nothing new here. We can also consider a block of implicit layers, which is, viewed as a numerical integrator of an ODE. Well, it's just like numerical integration of an ODE on some time interval, right? You just stack implicit layers one after another. And in this case, you can view the parameters of the layer as being some time-dependent function, and the natural choice is to consider a piecewise constant function. Let's say Cadillac function, which is takes values at the left endpoint and is continuous at the right endpoint. It's just one possible choice, natural choice for this case. Well, for the nonlinear map, we consider two particular very simple choices. These are classical theta schemes. One where theta goes outside of the nonlinear function, one when theta goes inside the nonlinear function. Each of these schemes have their cons and pros. Well, for instance, the second scheme can be a symplectic integrator, while the first one cannot. This can be an important property for some applications also. Also, one thing to mention is that when theta is between 0 and 1, the first scheme requires... So the first layer contains parameters from both endpoints, right? So you have parameter for at the left endpoint, you also have parameter at the right endpoint. So while for the second layer, you only need parameter at the left endpoint for this layer. So doesn't make much difference, but sometimes it might make a difference. Something to keep in mind. With these functions, these maps at hand, we can easily find their derivatives, their Jacobians with respect to all their parameters. These are very simple, explicitly available, but we will need them on the next slide to derive the backpropagation formulas. So that's how we implement the implicit layers. The forward propagation requires us to solve a nonlinear system. Well, that's basically a definition of the implicit layer. So we define the residual of our layer, and we want it to be zero in order to correspond to the definition. That means that we have to minimize this nonlinear function, the squared residual, and the output of this minimization problem will give us, that's the output of our layer. So that's a non-linear problem. You can solve it in many different ways. One natural way is to apply the descent algorithm, and it is natural in this case because, well, when we if we apply deep learning framework to solve our problem, then any deep learning framework is essentially a toolkit, a software tool to which implements these descent algorithms, all of them, almost all of them, and in an optimized fashion, optimized to the particular kind of problems people use when people happen to use these frameworks. So no external tools are required. So I've just mentioned some of these classical descent algorithms here, gradient descent in all their flavors. I mean, these are, every framework has these. Quasi-Newtons such as LBFGS, for instance, often is available as well. We are using LBFGS with PyTorch, for instance. Conjugate gradient, sometimes present, sometimes not. But, well, I mean, these two will work if the framework supplies them. Obviously, I mean, if there is a need to interface external solver, that is also possible, no problem. That might be required to do for the scaling reason, so maybe there's some specific scientific application, maybe you just have some awesome solver you want to use. But for that, you can still use the framework to help you in solving the nonlinear system, because, well, if your method, if external solver requires estimating the gradients of the residual, as in all these descent algorithms, well, then you can use the automatic differentiation capabilities of a deep learning framework to supply those exact gradients to the external solver. Some interfacing will be required. It will add a bottleneck to the problem. It will slow down a bit, but that is possible to do. So we have a nonlinear solver for the forward propagation. Fortunately, for the backward propagation, no nonlinear solver is required. All we need to do is to solve a linear system once. And we need to solve one linear system to backpropagate both the gradients with respect to the parameters and the inputs to the layer. So that is also good. And we can do that easily because, well, we know the exact Jacobian of an implicit layer, and we can find it because we require that our implicit layer gives us the fixed point at the end. So we converge to the fixed point, and that's the reason why that other paper, which employs a similar idea to others, is introducing additional memory footprint because, well, they do not converge to the fixed point. Well, at least the version of the paper I saw, and that's why they have to keep all the intermediate activation. So we converge to the fixed point. We can find the exact Jacobian. We know the Jacobian. We can find the backpropagation formulas. So given the gradient of the loss function with respect to the output of the layer, the gradients with respect to the inputs are given immediately by these formulas, while these highlighted values come from this from solving the linear system. So this linear system is basically pretty much encodes this inverse, this matrix inverse. Okay, so for this slide, there is not much to say here. Just, well, there is a graph of the forward propagation, computational graph of the backward propagation. Notice that the all operations involving a nonlinear solver are disabled, these dashed lines from the backward propagation. So yes, you need to provide a nonlinear solver. As discussed, it's not a problem with deep learning frameworks. And then in our implementation, we have this FP map fixed point map function, which in PyTorch notation is a torch function with the and we use torch function to provide a custom backward propagation which implements the linear solver discussed on the previous slide as well. So essentially, so you provide this backward solver, and then all derivatives with respect to inputs and outputs encoded in this map are calculated automatically. Okay, so that's all you have to do: provide nonlinear solver, provide linear solver, ensure that everything that parameters and inputs to the nonlinear solver are detached from the graph, like using detach capability of PyTorch or stop gradient in TensorFlow. But that's all you have to do indeed to implement the layer. And we have our implementation available on GitHub. It's hidden now, but I will open the repository soon. Okay, so this explains the tool, the hammer. Now let's go and talk a bit about the problem we can solve with this hammer. So we want to have, our goal is to have a stable and robust algorithm for deep learning. So we have a method which can have good stability properties. Now we have to we need to have a network. It's a structure of the network which can give us those stability properties to preserve by our tool. One way to get this structure is by imposing a hard constraint on the design of the network. That's the approach taken by Hebron Rutetel, for instance, in order to work stable architectures for deep learning, for deep neural networks, and deep neural networks motivated by partial differential equations. So they proposed, among others, they proposed at least these two they had there, two variants to impose the structural stability of the neural network by design. One is and recall that for the continuous system, so we view all these methods, all these networks as approximations of the continuous system. For the continuous system to be stable, the eigenvalues of the Jacobian, essentially of this nonlinear function, must belong to the left-hand plane. So that's the condition described here. So the Hebron Rutetel propose two types of structures. The parabolic structure will ensure that the eigenvalues will strictly belong to the negative real axis. Two variants are possible to achieve this. The hyperbolic structure or Hamiltonian structure will ensure that the eigenvalues of the Jacobian are strictly imaginary. I mean, while this is good, and sometimes for certain applications can be very beneficial, especially when you know that your data is coming from conservative system, a Hamiltonian system, or it's a diffusion, and you know that, and you want to have that kind of structure, these are excellent choices. In other cases, it can be a bit too restrictive. These are very good architectures, but I mean, you have it's a bit too restrictive sometimes. And we can do better, maybe. So that's where another approach can be used, approach of imposing the structure by regularization. One way to have to ensure stability of a deep network is to control its Lipschitz constant, to look at the Lipschitz continuity of deep networks. So Lipschitz constant is a convenient measure for the sensitivity of a function to the perturbations of the input data, just from its mere definition. We know that the Lipschitz constant is the largest singular value of the Jacobian of the nonlinear function, so that's what we have here. Well, obviously, I mean, neural networks are not arbitrary nonlinear functions. They usually have compositional structure. So these are compositions of affine functions and entry-wise nonlinearities, which are commonly non-expansive, which means that the norm is less or equal than one. That allows us to find the upper bound for the Lipschitz constant of the whole network as a product of the of the singular values of the fine of the weight matrices of the fine maps comprising the deep network itself. So essentially, if you want the network to be the deep network to be stable, We better have these weight matrices having singular values close to one. If they're greater than one, then if you have a very deep network, those values will accumulate and you'll have unstable behavior. If they're close to zero, they will vanish. Also, no desirable behavior. Close to one, less than one, but close to one is an ideal ideal situation. That's why. Weight normalization is a common approach to control the Lipschitz continuity of deep networks. So it's essentially what it does is just normalizing the weight. So you have a weight of the weight matrix. You just normalize it, just divide by the spectral norm, right? And that will ensure the required property. Well, this of course requires estimation of the spectral norm, and evaluation of the exact spectral norm for the arbitrary matrix can be very costly, especially when considering that you have to reevaluate the model many times during the training process. But if you have some cheap iterative method which allows you to evaluate the spectral norm, you can make it a part of the optimization procedure by taking several, usually one, iterations of that iterative method. And since the whole training process is expected to converge to at some point, this approach will make sense. And that's indeed what is commonly employed in practice by using the power iteration method to estimate the spectral, to implement the spectral normalization of the linear layers. Another approach is by using Jacobian penalization, which can be done by bounding the spectral norm with the Frobenius norm. The Frobenius norm is very easy to calculate, of course, but it is the Jacobian which is costly to evaluate. It's possible to find the exact Jacobian with any framework, but it scales linearly with the dimension of the cost scales linearly with the dimension of the Jacobian matrix, and that is not good. That can be very expensive and not required. Well, similarly to the iterative power iteration method, one can employ a randomized algorithm. In particular, Hutchinson unbiased randomized stochastic Hutchinson estimator for the trace of a matrix to estimate the Frobenius norm of the Jacobian. So we know that the Frobenius norm is the trace of any matrix A is by definition the trace of A transpose, and then we have the Hutchinson's estimator for the transpose of an arbitrary matrix. So this is A transpose is our matrix. That's the Hutchinson estimator, which is the expectation of the product of some of the random vector, which is usually taken to be standard normal with this matrix from both sides. And this expectation gives you the unbiased trace estimator. Well, we can recognize easily that, well, this particular product has a special structure which allows us to write the estimate of the Frobenius norm of the Jacobian matrix as expectation of the Jacobian vector product squared. And this is a very, very good structure because automatic differentiation packages, all they do is they evaluate Jacobian vector products. So this can be done easily with any deep learning framework which has automatic differentiation package inside of it. So this is pretty cheap, and again, you don't have to estimate to take many samples for the Monte Carlo estimator for the expectation. Similarly, commonly to the power iteration method, usually one or several iterations is only taken, and it works pretty well. Well, this is just a short slide on how to implement spectral normalization. One way to do it. This is a nice way because. Or the algorithm given on the right side, because it does not requires any estimates a priori, analytical estimates. All you need to do and is a way to apply a linear operator, arbitrary linear operator, and a convolution operator to a vector. And it is good because you do not have to form a matrix of the convolution operator. I like this approach because it allows to do it in a nice way. Though, I mean, again, many, if not all, frameworks provide some built-in capabilities for spectral normalization, which can be readily used for the purpose. Well, this slide shows the regularization approach we are taking specifically to our problem. So this is a regularization tailored to our problem, and that's how we justify it. When we train our neural network, right, we view it as a dynamic system. When we train it, what it essentially does. So we have a training data set, and a neural network trains some trajectories starting on those training data sets, and well, evolving according to the learned law. So let's consider one of such trajectories and the point on the trajectory, and linearize the vector field around the point on the trajectory. And the spectrum, the eigenvalues of the Jacobian matrix, highlighted in red here again, Jacobian matrix will obviously tell us the local behavior of the vector field in the vicinity of the point on the trajectory. And why do we need that? Because, well, we want the trajectory to be attractive, the point to be attractive. So if you perturb it, well, it stays close, or with time going on, it goes back and glues back to the trajectory. Well, this is in the line of the classical Lyapunov stability criterion. Whatever starts close, remains close, or converges to the same point asymptotically. Let's consider a point here in the middle of this figure, or this figure, and we have a trajectory coming through that point. So essentially what we want the vector field to be locally attractive around that point, right, centered around that point. And the divergence of the vector field around the point gives us the criterion for that. So we want the divergence to be negative. So what we have? We have a Jacobian matrix. We know that the trace of the Jacobian matrix is by definition the divergence of the vector field. So, okay, we need to know the divergence of the, we can find the divergence of the vector field around the point by evaluating the trace of the matrix. We also know that the trace of the matrix is by definition the sum of the eigenvalues of the matrix. With no regard to the choice of the coordinate system, that's a matrix invariant, also very nice property. So if you know the trace of the Jacobian matrix, we know the sum of all the eigenvalues. We also know that the trace of the Jacobian matrix can be estimated by using the Hutchinson estimator discussed in the previous slide, stochastic estimator. And again, so it has Jacobian vector product here. So we do not need to know the exact Jacobian, the full Jacobian. The only thing we need to know is how to compute Jacobian vector products, which can be done pretty efficiently. So pretty much this gives us our regularizer, and that's how we formulate our optimization problem. Minimize the loss function over the parameters, and plus we have two regularizers. We have regularizer. We regularize the divergence of the vector field along the trajectory. With some coefficient multiplied, and we penalize the Frobenius norm of the vector field along the trajectory. For those of you who have seen this paper, How to Train a Neural View, a recent paper, I mean, we can recognize some similarities. I mean, the authors of this paper provided very nice and elegant connection. And motivation for the choice of the Jacobian matrix penalization by connecting it to the optimal transport problem. So they had very elegant and nice justification here. But at the end of the day, well, we penalize the Jacobian matrix we make the vector field less sensitive around the point. We have it like locally close to a constant, so that's expected. So that makes sense by itself. Well, that paper also has this term in their problem, but it comes with a negative sign, and that is because it's not a part of the regularizer, as in our case. But in their case, it's a part of the loss function, and their loss, the problem they consider is the problem of learning the normalizing flow with neural ODEs. And well, the divergence of the vector field comes from the log determinant term of the variable change formulas for probability distributions when you estimate the normalizing flows. And they have the negative, so they minimize the negative divergence, which essentially maximizing the divergence. Well, we, in our case, we have a flipped situation. We minimize the divergence. We want it to be attractive, right? We want it to be as negative as possible. So that's the difference. But yes, well, the connection can be made also, and similarities can be mentioned. Well, another way to implement these regularizers is to use the so-called holo networks. Well, I literally copy-pasted this figure from this nice paper, so all credit goes to them. Neural networks with cheap differential operators. Essentially, the holo networks, what it does, so it's a sort of intrusive way to build a neural network in a way which allows exact evaluation of the diagonal of the Jacobian matrix with a single backward pass at a cost of some additional forward passes. I mean, again, nothing comes for free, but that still can be beneficial. And you have exact diagonal of the Jacobian matrix, and hence exact trace can be nice feature as well. And you also have a holo. That's the name for the whole network. You have a hollow part of the Jacobian. So you have the diagonal of the Jacobian, and you have the part of the Jacobian with main diagonal removed. And, well, with this definition, well, we can penalize the trace. We can penalize the trace of the Jacobian in this regularizer. And instead of penalizing the full Jacobian matrix, we can penalize the non-diagonal elements only. And the Frobenius norm can be estimated with the Hutchinson estimator again. So that's also a possible approach, which we also implement. Okay, going to examples. So I have two examples here: the regression and 1D regression and binary classification. More examples can be found in the paper, but here just two. Well, it's 1D regression, but well, the dynamics is two dimensional. So we do this in the line of augmented neural ODEs approach, which is a necessary condition. So it is necessary to augment your original system with additional dimensions if you want the network to be injective. Now, not the case for that's not the case for discrete dynamics, but it's a nice property to have, and we do that. So we have a two-dimensional dynamics here. So the data, in this case, what, it's just 5 points of this function. We want to feed just 5 points, and we take this parabolic. On this first slide, we take parabolic structure, right? We impose this hard constraint. Okay, we have a pure diffusion. And that's what we learn. So the first column shows the result, the regression result for three different methods: classical ResNet corresponding to theta equals to 0, then midpoint ResNet corresponding to theta equals to 0.5, and like backward ResNet theta equals to 1. A second column shows the stability regions along with the eigenvalues of the evaluated along the trajectory starting on training and test data sets. Third column shows the dynamic itself. We take, so we have the depth of the network is 5. We have 5 steps, 5 residual layers, and some statistics in the last column. So what we can see here that our unconditionally stable midpoint and backward Euler schemes are obviously, I mean, performing very well. The ResNet is not performing well. Well, the structure of the of the network does not fit well the method. So we have some unstable modes, and that is because the stability condition is very restrictive. Without imposing any other constraints, that's the kind of situation you can expect. And by the way, for all the networks we use in these examples, we do perform spectral normalization on the weight matrices of each network used for the right hand side of residual layers. So we do spectral normalization. So essentially, this is the Lipschitz one function. But then we also multiply it. I didn't show it here, but we multiply it with the scaling matrix, which is also learned. So the scales are also estimated as a part of the training process. Okay, so that's expected behavior for 5 points. For 10 points, it's not that bad. Everything is stable. So when you have enough data, you may be fine. When you have scarce data, sparse data, you can have this sort of overfitting due to the instability if you do not pay attention to the kind of architecture and the structure and to the kind of method you apply. Okay, well, this is the same problem with the Hamiltonian network again. So you see, yes, we have purely imaginary eigenvalues everywhere. And again, the ResNet is purely expansive. The backward earlier is, it's a pure diffusion, right? It goes to zero, as expected. No surprise that trapezoidal scheme performs the best here. Both you can see that in terms of dynamics and in terms of the final result. As for the statistics, you can see the number of nonlinear iterations, the number of linear iterations of the backpropagation. These are reasonable numbers. Okay. Now, okay, same problem with the multilayer perceptron, unstructured multilayer perceptron. When I say unstructured, I mean no parabolic, no hyperbolic explicit structure. It still has spectral normalization for all the weights, and the overall multilayer perceptron is multiplied by the scaling matrix, which is learned on the fly. But no regularization other than that is used. So that's what we have here. Dynamics is not unstable. It's all stable. You have some eigenvalues in the bad part of the region, but they're close to zero, so that's not a big deal. But the vector fields, when you look at them, you can see that they're susceptible to make your network sensitive to perturbations. In two dimensions, not a big deal. In high dimensions, like convolutional networks, when you have 100 dimensions or so, that can be a big deal. Something to keep in mind. Same problem, 10 points. More points, more degrees of freedom. The behavior of the network is also a bit different. So you see now that the eigenvalues are trying to push it to the unstable region more and more, and the dynamics reflects this picture. But again, just for 10 points, it's okay. And it's two dimensions, not a big deal. But this is something to pay attention to. Well, now let's try and regularize our multilayer perceptron. So we employ the divergence regularizer with this constant. If you compare, it doesn't do much, but it does push the spectrum to the left half plane, and the vector field is also acts more like a diffusion. So as expected, and that's the trace regularizer. It's a stochastic Hutchinson estimator we employed here, so that's why we can see these oscillations for all three different methods. The result is good. Well, different alpha. Different alpha. pretty much almost all eigenvalues now belong to the stable part, which is okay. The vector field is also changed quite significantly. So it's all essentially we almost learn a slow manifold, one-dimensional slow manifold for this system. I can take even larger alpha. That's now where we have a problem for the ResNet. Yeah, because well, you keep pushing it, you can push it too hard. And that's what you have. You have instability, you have instability here. Well, both implicit schemes are stable. I mean, they're stable, but training such networks requires more effort, as you can see. It doesn't feed the data very well. No, it's stable. It's possible to feed the data well and be stable, but it just requires more effort. And I didn't pay much attention to that. That wasn't the goal. The goal was to show stability. Now same problem with the hollow multilayer perceptron structure with no regularization. I mean, same behavior. I mean, if you know regularization, all eigenvalues are trying to be. To go to the bad part of the region, because that gives it more degrees of freedom, right? It feels more freedom there. The network is more free there. That's why it pushes it to that region. But again, for 10 points, that's okay. Let's apply some regularization. That's what we have. Similar behavior, also like diffusive flows. Most eigenvalues in the stable parts of the region. Now you see that the trace is exact here because we use hollow multilayer perceptron network. So the regularizers are decaying like in a smooth fashion. There is no stochastic oscillations. Sorry. Okay, same problem with the different alpha. I mean, nothing new here. Same. Okay, now, similar behavior. We have alpha too large. And the network becomes unstable. You can see this is not that bad, but you can see oscillations here at the end and some oscillations here. And again, for 2D problem, not a big deal. That will be a big deal for high dimensional problems. The second problem is the binary classification. So we have a spiral data set we want to separate. Same approach, unstructured multilayer perceptron, train, okay, this terrible situation. The result, okay, reflects the spectrum, right? So, I mean, this region, I mean, that's not what you expect from a robust network. Let's do some regularization, increase the regularization. See behavior of the eigenvalues. I mean, pushing a bit to the left, not a big deal. Okay, now with this value of the regularizer, well, this is a perfect thing. I mean, yes, you do have unstable eigenmodes. It's okay to have unstable eigenmodes. You do not necessarily have to have all of them strictly. Forcing the system to decay and to act like a diffusion. This is probably too much, but the final result is okay. It's perfect. It's much less satisfactory for both implicit networks. And again, this is a classical ResNet for theta equals 0, theta 0, 5, theta 1. These I just didn't have time to play with it. As I mentioned, the training becomes more difficult with implicit schemes. And the reason why these fail probably because the initialization was not the best for this kind of network. You see, these white regions for midpoint scheme and for backward scheme. So they have a poles somewhere in this region. So I think the trapezoidal scheme has a pole here at this point, and the backward scheme has a pole at this point. And you better initialize and restrict your network so that those poles are avoided, and I didn't do that. That can be done. But anyway, when compared to itself, without regularization, it behaves better. Not as satisfactory as for ResNet with that equals to zero, but well, that's due to lack of time. It can be done much better. And I think okay, yeah, here is that was the last slide. So these are two references on our work, our paper. This is an old version archive. It doesn't have most of the material I presented today. New version expected by end of September. Also the GitHub code, this link, currently a private repository. I will open it when we push a new version of the paper to archive. Expect sometime by end of September, November. Okay. So these are some references I have used in this presentation. And with this, I want to conclude and thank you for your attention.